Good morning. I'd like to welcome you at the first talk of last day. Well, it's pity it's last day, but I need to tell you a bit about what happened, the story about the story. This presentation was originally meant to be held by Brenno de Winter, but he couldn't be here because there was serious illness in his family. And so he asked Walter to replace him, and I know Walter hacked this presentation together quite quickly, but yeah, then he came with a request that I would do give him a hand with some technical stuff in the talk. So I'm here with two pets, Harold and Speaker, and well, let's say Walter, start a talk and call me when you need me.
Thank you. Well, the title is Why Technology Sucks, but you could equally say why do politicians suck? This is more or less two stories in one. And it's mostly about how technology tends to be abused for something which is not a technological issue, but maybe a political issue or accountability issue. And it also brings problems to the surface, which may already have been there, but have become more urgent because of technology. Those two, well, it's a bit strange to start with the conclusions, but I hope you will leave with a similar conclusion. Basically, like I said, it's two stories rolled in one. The first part, which will be presented by me, is mostly about the Dutch OV chip card, which is a public transport smart card. The second part is also about the Dutch implementation of the data retention directive we all know about. And it's also about Small Sister, which is a new open source project, which is a direct response to the data retention directive implementation. And we will close off with some Q&A if necessary. Anyway, let's start with the overchip card. Well, Erich Honecke, if he had still been alive, he would really be delighted by the overchip card. I'm aware of saying that in a building dating back from that era, but I'm really sure that the well, you can sort of say that his ghost is still lingering around and has even managed to escape Germany and go to the Netherlands. And I'll try to explain this maybe somewhat harsh statement further in my following slides. But first of all, let me explain the problem that the overchip card is supposed to be solving. Public transport is, well, like in almost every European country, you do have a railway system, which is mostly run by the National Railway, Nederlandse Spoorwegen. You do have some regional railways, but they tend to be lumped together with the regional public transport, which is also mostly buses, some ferries. And you do have urban transport, which is, just like here in Berlin, it's mostly buses, some trams, some metro systems. They do have a bunch of terrace systems, which actually are already pretty uniform. You do have your railway tickets, which look like these, with a fancy holographic strip for authenticity. And you do have the national tariff system, which looks like this. Basically, the whole of the Netherlands is divided in zones, and you can buy so-called strippenkaarten, and those are tickets with strips, and you have to validate a number of strips depending on the number of zones you're traveling through. And it's kind of an old-school prepaid ticket system. It allows you to buy a bunch of strippenkaarten, let's say, in the deep south, and still be able to travel around in the far north of the country, which is still a small country, of course. But and the interesting bit about this is that the revenues are shared between all the various transport companies. It's especially when you use it the first time, and for tourists it's a nightmare, but it works, and it works quite well from an end-user perspective. And you also have, oh, I'm going too fast here. And you have all sorts of passes which form a subscription. The one in the back is my own, which happens to be a national pass, which is valid in both on trains and in the regional transit systems. But you also have regional passes, etc. And again, in most cases, this involves some revenue sharing between the public transport companies. Which brings me to the problems. No one has actually a real idea who really deserves the revenues from all those tickets. Every year they come together and calculate some model in which everyone gets a piece of the pie, and no one really knows how many of those tipping cards end up unused in the desk or something like that, or are really used. And at the same time, there's an issue about security or people feeling unsafe in public transport. So apparently the obvious solution is to come up with a system where we gate all stations with electronic gates, booths, and because then no one will be able to dodge fares, is the thinking. But obviously, since those are stations, in case of an emergency, you have to be able to open the gates. And those are really easy to open the gates. You can kick them open. And of course, fare dodgers would never do such an antisocial thing. So this is a surefire way to solve this safety or security problem. Basically, what I have come up with is that they have taken a already fairly complicated tariff system, looked at the most technological advanced solution in the market out there, which is the Octopus card in Hong Kong and the Oyster card in London, which are both urban transit systems with, compared to the Dutch system, exceedingly simple tariff systems, and are based on the now world-famous MyFare Classic chip, which I'm not sure most people here know about. And the idea is that you get a chip with an MyFare Classic chip on it, which serves as an electronic wallet, and you put some money on it, you check in at the gates, at the stations, when you enter, and you check out when you leave, and then all of a sudden we know how much you've actually been traveling at what time. So, and you can get neat bills afterwards. The slide now on is an overview of my last 10 trips. Well, not really, because I usually refuse to check in since it's still not mandatory. It's going to be mandatory in Rotterdam, where I live, after the 29th of January. But of course, I was a bit curious about it, whether it does work. And indeed, you can get an overview online on the web. I have no idea how secure that website is. And I can look up how often I've checked in and checked out. And you can see at the top one, for those who can read Dutch, it says, check in, vraag uw OV-bedrijf. I didn't check in. So the system doesn't know how I popped in, but I did pop out at station Rotterdam Alexander. And the other trip, I did check in and I did check out. What this overview doesn't show is, but it's, you can look that up on some systems at the stations themselves, is the actual time frame, actual time you checked in and you checked out. Which is lovely, of course, because then you can tell for every user in your public transport system how they have been traveling. And that's why I said why Erich Honecker would have been so pleased with a system like this. Because I'm sure that even the Stasi wasn't able to tell where everyone was traveling in those days. And on top of that, TransLink Systems, which is actually running these systems, claims that it is obliged by tax law to keep those records around for 7 years. And although there is no data retention for travel data whatsoever in the Netherlands, not yet, because we have another lovely upcoming scheme, which is congestion charging, which probably will be applied for the whole of the country. But very few people are aware, because this piece of legislation snuck through almost unobserved, is that prosecutors, public prosecutors, can request data from any company in as part of a criminal prosecution. So if you happen to be in under scrutiny of the police, it's fairly easy. If you happen to be one of those dirty hippies who travels by public transport, that they will request the TransLink for your travel behavior in the past. And this is completely outside the scope of any data retention laws as we know all about them as we know them in telecommunications. So that's why I consider this a bit of a privacy problem. But how transparent have those people who are involved in this mega project been themselves? Well, Benno has been asking around, because he's a journalist, about all the security measures taken regarding the system, which is obviously a very interesting target for people with malicious intents. More or less triggered by last year's presentation by Karsten and Henrik about the vulnerabilities in the MIFARE chip here at CC. And so far he has sent out about 10, we don't call it Freedom of Information Act, but it's roughly equivalent to what in Germany is called the Freedom of Information Act, to the various parties involved. He's got 6 answers. Not all of those answers were all that satisfactory, because apparently some of the documents he requested were not there yet. I mean, we're talking about a system which is to be rolled out during this year, and apparently some security strategy documents are still not finished. Here's one ongoing, which is the most interesting one. He has actually asked the data commissioner, or the equivalent of a data commissioner, which is overviewing the data protection in the Netherlands, why they have agreed, or at least about documents on their decision making on actually agreeing with this going through. In the last 2 weeks, the data protection authority in the Netherlands has decided that they are okay with the way it goes forward. Even with the fact that all data will be retained unless you opt out of it. And they have done so separately for Dutch Railways and for the Rotterdam Public Transport Company. In the case of Dutch Railways has made the case that because they might be able to suit their service more to travelers' wishes, and that the use of public transport and the reduction of congestion is a legitimate public interest, it therefore there is a legitimate reason to keep all this personal data around, because now they can start one-on-one marketing, telling people, well, the train you always take is so crowded, but if you take a train 10 minutes earlier, it may be less crowded. And they hope to get a more efficient public transport system out of it. I largely doubt that it will really work, because one of the reasons most people take very crowded trains is that they have to be somewhere at some time, and the previous modes of transport may not have a good connection. And you're not going to change that by telling people that the earlier train is less crowded or the later one. There have been three flat-out refusals, and Brno has started one lawsuit in order to get documents out of it. We have no idea how long that will take and what the end result will be. He is going to file at least three new requests the coming weeks. Which is interesting itself, because the the Minister of Transport, not really the Secretary of Transport, started out after the My Fair disaster by telling that it was not an issue at all. After that, it was still not a problem, but a minor technical problem. And now they're in the modus that they will be waiting until there will be real abuse of the system, until they're going to fix the security in there. But there's good reason to assume that she may or may have to resign somewhere in the coming years over this project, because it's already about more than €1 billion over budget. And they still haven't gotten it working yet. So. That's the part about the OV chip card. Another part is about data retention and the Dutch implementation of that. In front, on the slide, there's a small part of the retention directive. Well, most people here know about it. There has been a demonstration against it last year. Yeah. The part highlighted is the date and time of the login of the internet email service of internet telephony service based on a certain time zone. That in itself is bad enough, given the fact that it's your private data. It's also probably fairly useless because of all the spam out there. But it's also a big problem in terms of informants to journalists. And that's why Brno really wants to have this put in the presentation. And I don't know about other European countries, but in the Netherlands, a journalist has a very limited right to be silent about whistleblowers anyway, but as far as he has one, if he doesn't know who really is, he really can't tell. And until now, email was a fairly safe method, because most ISPs get rid of their logging of email fairly soon anyway. There have been some extreme examples already of Dutch journalists having to disclose their sources. There's still a lingering scandal about a ex-marine who turned out to be a weapons supplier to organized drug syndicates. And some leaks about that were former employees of the Dutch intelligence service. And the journalists who received that information have been jailed for not disclosing that information, and all the phone calls got tapped. And it's to be expected that this is going to be happen in the future even more often, and also for email, now that there will be data retention, of course. And that's why Brno came up with a scheme called Small Sister in order to ascertain anonymity on the internet, and that's the part where Peter takes over from me in order to explain the technical side of it.
Okay, let's.
What is Small Sister? Well, it's a project, and one of the. There's actually two sides of the project. There is a big issue about raising awareness of privacy and security, because as some other talks showed, you cannot have privacy on your own computer if it is secure, if insecure enough to install keyloggers and things like that. So we talk about disk encryption, network privacy, and you know, Breno is trying to raise a lot of media buzz. And well, the awareness is for the general public, but if politicians pick it up, well, that would be good because they can change some things and maybe change some very stupid laws about data retention or other privacy measures. The second part is to build tools to fill privacy gaps. We have Tor and good proxies to make. So there's no use to make another Tor wannabe replacement because, well, Tor is there and Tor is doing a good job, or better job than I can do, in proxying information over the internet. I guess you'll know a longer list than I can present here, but there are a lot of tools that are there. But one of the things that has been missing is what I call data retention resistant email tool. And that's where I started planning, programming, and what happened, what we came up with. It's essentially an email-like client-server architecture that uses SSL or TLS over Tor. I mean, we like the work the guys at Tor do, but we don't want to need to trust them in keeping our information private. I mean, if you can encrypt the connection, all the better, because snooping is made harder even for Tor nodes, because we talk about end-to-end encryption and not Tor node to Tor node encryption. The last part, the part between Tor node and the application, is encrypted too. Servers, can be made anonymously. They are intended to live in the .onion domain, so that it can only be accessed by Tor and live as what Tor calls hidden servers, which protects the provider of the mail server. Well, if you have an email address, you don't know whether the server is in Europe, America, Africa, Antarctica. Well, maybe Antarctica could be found with a timing attack, but you know, it's hard to find where the server really lives, and it makes it hard for the authorities to find the server and try to collect or tap. One other thing is, if you can make anonymous accounts, or the server allows anonymous accounts, it means that he doesn't have to know his users personally. Well, a big threat to privacy are people that know you personally. I mean, Big Brother is liking to snoop on Small Sister, but hey, if you have some strangers, you even don't know their names on your server, what's your incentive to snoop on them when they use it the server normally? And one of the most important thing is, we didn't want to reinvent all wheels. We just wanted, when there are very good components on the market, things like PGP or GPG, Tor, OpenSSL, just link those things together. You can use the application and it's use the tools efficiently, use good tools, use tools that have been reviewed and are known to be, best in the market, open source tools. Yeah, let's take a look at whether we can make a view of how the application looks like. Okay, yeah. Here we have the application. I mean, it's a simple client application that talks to servers and take a look whether we've got
Hey.
We've got messages. Let's look at this. Hey. Do you... Hey, it's this is a message from Brenno, the original speaker. He sent from home and to the hidden server. And yeah, well, it seems let's send an email back and see what happens. Well, did you notice that the message was encrypted and that it was decrypted on the fly while I was reading it? Small feature.
Let's take a quick look at what. So.
Okay, let's encrypt it and send it off. Well, did you notice it was it has been encrypted yet? And well, it will be sending the email out, so let's go on with the talk. And where is the... Okay, where is it? No, the... Well, what would I do to make it more privacy enhanced? Well, I just dropped the concept of reusing SMTP. It has too much craft that came from the UUCP and BitNet times, and it was never designed to protect against privacy. So it's, and well, we had headers that leak information like, well, mad. It's can't preserve. So it's, what we do is we encrypt message and header as one single blob and just hand it over to a server. Well, it's the servers on the internet, so there's no need to have something routing a special server gatewaying it, so you can just dump it directly to the server with a message. Please put it in the mailbox for that user, or well, that key. It's not a user, it's just a random key that indicates a mailbox. And well, thanks to Tor, the server will not know where the message came from, whether it came from Europe or America. And I mean, it's only, it goes over Tor, so it's, there is anonymity in the transport protocol. And we only identify the recipient by its mailbox number, ID, random ID. And I have some recommendations for people that think of putting anonymity in. Use more mailboxes to prevent correlation attacks. If you have, if you are in a football club and member of the CCC, why don't have you three mailboxes, one for the football club, one for CCC, and one for the family? So that your family doesn't need to know that you're a CC member. And do that on different servers. It makes correlation attacks more difficult. Because when you check for new messages on the server with three mailboxes in a row, one can assume that you are the same person doing it, or the same client doing it. So it's better to have several mailboxes on different servers so that it requires the server operators to cooperate to try to find out whether mailbox A, B, and C belong to one user or to three different users. Yeah, we have a to-do list. I've been programming for 2 months, and I'm happy to have a running server and a running client, but I have this, it's only a small, it's only a few of the items on my list of things that I want to do. If there are people interested in doing it, the GUI is made in a WX Python, and if anyone is willing to learn it, but he can program with clean Python, you're welcome to contribute to the project. If you have good privacy enhancing ideas on how to do messaging, you're welcome. And yeah, I like to discuss. I even like people that are willing to review what I've done so far. I have some documentation, and you'll likely find it. You'll find pointers on our website. You can also mail to Brenno, who isn't here yet. And I'll just do a small check on whether the mail has been sent. Okay, it looks like the mail has been sent. I'm just doing the window. Okay, yeah. You can see, this is a debug window, but it shows that the mail has been sent to the server, and let's check whether Brenno has some reply for it. Okay. While the computer is working, time for question and answers. Anyone?
If you send an email, can you send it to a normal email address or only to a Hidden Onion email servers?
At the moment, the client only does our email protocol. So there's no gateway yet.
It's probably a good idea to keep this that way, because if you do it other way, you will disclose your hidden service, I think.
I've got some ideas, but let's say, but that's something I like to. It's hard to. Well, you get a two-way discussion here, and come over after the talk and discuss in more depth.
Disclosing the hidden service may not be such a problem after all, because the data retention mostly applies to access providers. There's still some uncertainty what an access provider really is. But as soon as you get to the hidden server, you may not really be an access provider.
I noticed that on your email address, your contacts, they're hash files. Do you have a way to make them aliases, or do you have to remember what each hash is for each person? If you've got like 3 or 4, that's fine, but if you've got 100, it's more difficult.
I already implemented an address book, but I just have I want to make a small enhancement by allowing the user to give it a name and put it before the address. So I was glad I had an address book and got it working in time for the conference. you know what I mean? And I didn't want to break things by changing it in the remaining 2 days.
I have a question about the transport chip card. Is it personalized in the Netherlands? Because the Octopus card you mentioned from Hong Kong is not personalized. You can give it back at any time, get the full amount stored on the card back, or put it on another card. So it's not that privacy invasive.
That's one of the reasons why it's such a mess, because they've chosen two options. Either, there's a throwaway version, which is exceedingly insecure, but it's no problem, that's just a single fare ticket. There's an anonymous one, and there's a personal one. And the people who use the anonymous one do not apply for discount rates. So the Dutch are rather frugal people. No one will hardly anyone will use the anonymous one. And in case of subscriptions, you can't use the anonymous one. The one I showed on the slide in the back was my own one. And since I do have a subscription to all public transport in the Netherlands, I cannot use an anonymous one. So you can fairly safely assume that over 90% of the users will use a personalized card. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
There was another hand in the front over there.
Yes. So how do you store emails in this system? Is it possible to mount a denial of service attack by registering lots of accounts and sending lots of email and not retrieving it again?
Technically, well, with the current server, it's possible, but yeah, it's something that can be fixed by using a quotum system on the server, limit number of accounts. I have some ideas to restrict creation of accounts to certain numbers, but it's, yeah, those are things, more cryptographic tricks, and it will go a bit too deep to talk about it now, and because it's ID. You can, let's say, you can hand out a signing key to someone. The operator can hand out a signing key that allows the creation of 10 accounts by signing a key that is sent to the server and used as access key to the mailbox.
Yeah?
Could you elaborate how the message gets passed from one Onion mail server to another? How the different mail hosts discover each other?
At the moment, I assume it's internet or Tor, and all nodes are accessible from the client. So it's directly dump your email in the destination server from the client. It's no forwarding from between email servers, just directly place the email on the server, because it's internet and or Tor and all of the nodes are connected. Do you want to say more about it?
I've got a question about the encryption. What type of encryption do you use? Here in front.
Okay. The emails are with GNUPG encrypted. I mean, they are encrypted in the client before sending them to the server, and the server doesn't care about encryption or decryption. If you understand it, I mean, it's something like, and when a client retrieves them, he stores them locally on the file system in encrypted form. The only thing that's insecure is that the keys are on the client file system without passphrases. Another thing to do, but it protects the email. It will protect on the server, but could be better protected on the client. But one thing is, the client. If you get a raid, you will notice that your database has been cryptoed, and you only have to be aware about key loggers, etc.
Currently, do we have any kind of fail safes for the server nodes? I mean, it's an anonymous net, so any of the mail servers can technically go out at any time. And you won't find, maybe they won't go up again. So basically, the email, the mail on the server is gone. So what are you planning to do against that?
Breno had a plan to make clusters, meaning you have two or three, maybe four mail servers that know each other and forward the email. I mean, it's something like a cluster system where all mails are copied on all four servers, but that's. It's a good idea. It's something that requires time to implement. Actually, I haven't seen his design yet. So he will design it, and we will review it and go on. But I see there's some fresh email coming in, so you can take a...
What about spam? How do you handle spam on your mail system?
One very good one thing is you cannot do all about against spam. If you have an anonymous informer you want to receive email from, well, he might be informing you about a government problem. He also might want to inform you about his Viagra shop. How do you know the difference as mail server when the mail is encrypted? On the other hand, you don't need to have to hand out all your email addresses publicly. That's why I say keep them close knit in small. Keep one email address for a small group, and then you can even only accept in the client when you have decrypted the email. Well, I didn't expect anything from that key because I only expect email from a small group of people, and it makes it quite easy to detect spam. And there are a few. Well, I want to. There is a discussion, maybe discussion with Tor people, other people that know more about cryptography, because you might even ask the server to filter some things for you, but that will mean handing over information to the server as an anonymous user and giving information on the server about who your contacts are. People that are allowed to send email to your accounts are your contacts. And do you want to keep them locally on your local laptop or local PC, or give the information to a random server in another different country? That's a hard question to resolve with these kind of anonymous systems. And I don't want to make the decision for all my users. It's some of those decisions have to be made by the user because everyone has their own way of weighing the alternatives.
And maybe we shouldn't forget this is, first of all, a proof of concept, and secondly, its primary goal is to allow journalists to get a system which would allow whistleblowers to contact them. It's not really geared towards a mass audience, and I think spamming, by definition, is about mass communication. In the middle, in the back.
You said the keys are saved on the local hard disk. Is it already possible to use this client on different machines?
Yes, it's
without
possible.
Copying the keys all the time.
No, we're not. I'm working on some way to make a nice backup of your address book and keys so that you can easily copy them over. But maybe it's better to have your keys on a USB stick with your mail directories. It's possible to do it, that you can have it on a removable drive, and you can just carry the application and your keys with you, and your mail. It's proof of concept, and I like to have your creativity working on improving it.
No more questions? Okay, thank you very much.